Okay. Awesome. So this is our July XR Access Research Network seminar. And we're very excited to present today's speaker, Reginé Gilbert. Just a little bit about XR Access and the research network. We're led by Dr. Shiri Azenkot, who is a professor at Cornell Tech at Cornell University. And she is the director of the XR Access Initiative. And Ricardo Gonzalez, he's also a PhD student, one of Shiri's students at Cornell Tech, has done an amazing job in different aspects of XR Access. And myself, I actually am also one of Shiri's students, recently graduated. So I'll be starting as an industry assistant professor at NYU in the fall. And so our goal with the research network really is to make sure that we're a community that engages, connects, and influences the field of XR, so VR and AR. And our mission is to build and share knowledge, skills, tools, user experiences, and leading practices to make XR inclusive of all, regardless of abilities. And so the purpose of these seminars, essentially, is we want to be able to celebrate and share academic research with the collective goal of making XR technologies accessible through seminars and discussions. And so we really would like for this to be in the future, a community of researchers, so an idea or a place where we can come and share ideas, talk through new collaborations potentially. And so we really appreciate you all for joining today and seeing what research we have going on and hopefully being more involved in the future. And with that, just see Dylan, if there's no housekeeping things I have forgotten.
I think we're in good shape. Look forward to the symposium report soon is all I have to say.
Awesome, thank you. Okay, so we're, like I said, very excited to introduce Reginé Gilbert. And her talk today is entitled Inclusion and Accessibility in XR, Exploring Experiences. And if you have questions, you can put them in the chat and we will be doing a question and answer portion at the end. So I'm going to stop share. And Reginé, you have the floor.
Okay. Thank you, everyone, for being here today. It's really, I am a huge fan of XR Access. I got to attend the first symposium a few years back when we were, you know, in the before times. And I have been part of XR Access, not recently, but I used to be very involved. And so I'm really happy to be here to talk to you all about my ongoing research. So there are no, I don't have any final results to share, but I will be sharing with you what I have been working on. So I have the famous lines here. Can folks who can see my screen? Am I good?
Yes.
Good. Okay, great. Thank you. So yes, I go by Reginé and Reginé Gilbert. I'm an industry assistant professor at New York University in the Integrated Design and Media Program. I'm also part of the Ability Project. And here on the screen, I have a person who is wearing a VR headset with their hands spread out wide. So I want to first thank you to my research assistants over the years and my recent research assistants, Kayu Liu, Saki Asakawa, Asad Mahmood, Blessing Amole, Lauren Chun, and Isabella Lopez. Without, I could not do this work. So I just want to outline what I'll be talking about just in general. Research overview of XR uses. I feel like I'm preaching to the choir here, but I think it's always good to go over for anybody who may be new. Challenges in XR, existing guidelines, the gaps with existing guidelines, and then AR/VR heuristics. So I want to start with where I started, which was I got into this role as an industry assistant professor. And my background had been primarily looking at inclusion and accessibility in the web space. But I had a deep desire to learn more about the extended reality space, AR and VR, because one of the things I used to do was some usability testing for augmented reality. And I've co-created a couple of courses here through NYU for UX for AR and VR. And so I thought, what could I do? What could I research? And then I started thinking inclusion and accessibility in XR. But I had no idea how large that could potentially be. So my initial research plan was to apply universal design principles to XR technology areas, including tools for development, physical and digital environments, designs, and hardware. And then potentially, proposing inclusive guidelines of accessibility of XR experiences, and then ultimately testing with designers to see if our guidelines work at the beginning of a project. So I want to first go into accessible design and define a few things. So this is from Trina, which these are, I think, great assessment of accessible design. But accessible design minimizes barriers so that content and features can be accessed and used regardless of one's permanent, situational, or temporary disabilities in the areas of hearing, motor, vision, speech, and cognition. Since disability is only one aspect of identity, accessibility is one aspect of inclusive design. Inclusive design minimizes alienating any product-relevant social identity, disability, race, ethnicity, gender, skin color, age, size, sexual orientation, language, etc. Inclusive design commits to the due diligence of learning about your users to ensure designs not only meet business requirements, but also respect the needs and expectations of the diverse range of users the product serves. And then when talking exclusively about accessibility, call it accessible design, not inclusive design. A product can be accessible and still alienate other product-relevant identities, making the product ableist, misogynistic, racist, heteronormative, cisnormative, xenophobic, ageist, body shaming, skin tone biased, etc. Inclusive design is intersectional. So I want to make that clear for everyone here, the differences between accessibility and inclusion. So currently, XR is being used with artificial intelligence, assistive technology, business and retail, communications, education, empathy, entertainment, recreation, events, gaming, health, rehabilitation, meetings, navigation, therapy, training, video programming, virtual assistants, and wayfinding. There are some accessibility challenges within XR, with both AR and VR. Accessibility is often an afterthought. We who are in this industry know that very well. Controllers often require use of both hands. Inputs and outputs of experiences don't offer accessibility options. Affordances and usability do not account for people with disabilities. Depending on the medium, up to 90% of an environment cannot be controlled. Experience depend on bodies being in certain positions in order to move, and experiences are based on audio or visual alone. So there's some guidelines I'm going to go through that are existing out there, and these are the W3C guidance. So some things designers and authors need to be aware of are understanding specific diverse user needs and how they relate to XR, successfully identifying modality needs that are not obvious but still need to be supported, suitable authoring tools that support accessibility requirements in XR, using languages, platforms, and engines that support accessibility semantics, providing accessible alternatives for content and interaction, the provision of specific commands within VR environments, for example, to go directly to a specified location or to follow another user, which assists with navigation to support different modalities. Immersive semantics and customization, motion agnostic interactions, and immersive personalization. Interaction and target customization, color changes, magnification context and resetting, critical messaging and alerts, gestural interfaces and interactions, immersive semantics and customization, motion agnostic, sorry, I already went through some of these, but motion agnostic interactions, immersive personalization, interaction and target customization, voice commands, color changes, magnification, context and resetting, critical messaging and alerts, and gestural interfaces and interactions. Second screen devices, interaction speed, avoiding sickness triggers, spatial audio tracks and alternatives, spatial orientation, mono audio options, captioning, subtitling, and text, support and customization. So the use of virtual assistive technologies, for example, the white cane via a haptic device to provide non-visual feedback. The research identified that if the same audio cues associated with a real-world infrared white cane were used in an immersive environment, users were able to effectively center themselves in the middle of pathways and walk successfully through virtual doorways based on the same audio feedback as used in the equivalent real-world device. And that's from Maidenbaum Amendi. So the thing with the W3C guidelines, they're really great and they are very general, but they are general for both AR and VR. And one of the things after going through those requirements that we thought about was there really should be separate guidelines for AR and VR. They shouldn't be combined because they're totally different. And for those who work in it, you know. So this question I'm throwing out there, and I would love to know, when you think of someone who uses VR or AR, who do you think of? And if possible, could you let me know in the chat? And I mean, body types, ethnicity, who are you thinking of? Gender. When you think of someone who uses VR or AR, who do you think of? And if somebody could help me read them out, because I don't have my two screens happening today, that would be great.
Sure, I'll read them out.
Thank you.
We have teenager.
Okay.
Tech savvy.
Okay.
Seeing individuals, two arms / hands, often men.
Okay.
Given the groups I work with, mostly able-bodied.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. Thank you for sharing. So I've asked this question to a lot of people, and in general, it's like a cisgendered white male, average age of 24, is what people think of when you think of someone who uses VR or AR. And I said, well, a lot of people don't think of a non-binary person who's in a wheelchair, who's 50 years old, who really wants to use VR and never has. And my question to all of us is, why aren't we thinking of other people, right? When we think about who is using VR or AR. So, you know, designers focus on human-centered design oftentimes. But the question we have to continually ask ourselves is, which humans are we focusing on? Because it tends to be the same. And the truth is we need to broaden who we think about when we think about the humans that we're focusing on. So I'm going to touch on a little bit of my ongoing research, which is kind of vast at this point. I actually was speaking to my research assistant earlier, like we need to bucket some of these things. So I've been examining inclusion and accessibility in the XR space for the last couple of years. So my ongoing research began with me examining tools used to create XR experiences, looking at evaluated costs, if something is enterprise used by corporations, what the purpose is, accessibility features, programming language, scripting languages, supporting platforms, system requirements, and features. So here on the screen, I have Google Sheets, showing the name of tools, cost, enterprise, purpose, accessibility features, programming languages, scripting languages, supported platforms, system requirements, and features. And the reason that I decided to focus in on these areas was because if something costs money, one big part of inclusion that gets often left out is whether people can afford things or not, because not everybody can afford the tools that are out there. So if something costs money, that could be a barrier of entry. In addition, an area I wanted to focus on was the scripting language, because if you are not familiar with C# and you want to get into Unity, it could be a little bit of an uphill battle, because a lot of times when you're working in Unity, you will need to update scripts. And if you're not familiar with that, that could be, again, a barrier to entry. So we evaluated 49 tools, and 8 out of the 49 tools had some sort of accessibility features mentioned on the website. However, the truth is, really, like 4 out of those had actual things that could be utilized. So what I do want to share that came out of that is that I did discover that there are plugins and things that can be used with these tools. So I'm going to go through a few of those. And ultimately, we created this because I am a designer. And Saki Asakawa and I came up with this. I have a fascination with subway maps. So here, the image description is a neon sign of XR City. It's an opaque subway map with stops at free game, VR accessibility, and AR. So ultimately, we ended up creating a subway map. So on the screen, I have the XR City map. This we created last May of 2021. And this subway map will show you where you want to go depending on what you'd like to do. So if you want to, we have lines for gaming, drawing, AR, 3D, character, prototyping, modeling, animation. We also have a little stop for A11Y, which is the numeronym for accessibility. There are 11 characters between the A and the Y. And then if there's an enterprise plan available, and if things were specific to VR, we also specified if things were paid only, paid and free. So again, out of this, learning that there, you know, there's not much in terms of accessibility for these tools themselves. However, there are some resources for content creators and developers that exist. So there's Xability. These accessibility APIs enable developers to design, set, and modify game accessibility features and information in their game. For example, developers can configure closed caption properties, the high contrast mode, and the text edge style. Developers can also modify the text that displays on the speech-to-text window and the position of the speech-to-text window. There's, for visual accessibility, spatial sound for app developers for Windows, Xbox, and HoloLens 2. Documentation on how to implement Microsoft's platform-level solution for spatial sound support on Xbox, Windows, and HoloLens 2, enabling both surround and elevation audio cues. The spatial sound APIs within allow developers to create audio objects that emit audio from positions in 3D space. There's Dolby Games and Dolby Atmos. Dolby site with great conceptual documentation on spatial sound. Included are links to Dolby Atmos resources for WY's FMOD, Xbox, PC, and mobile. There's Project Acoustics, documentation and tools for a wave of acoustic engine that simulates acoustics as sound travels through 3D environments. It's great for sighted developers designing audio accessibility in their games, as they can use this technology to see how the sound in their game travels and interacts within game objects. There's Azure Voice, text-to-speech service with incredibly natural-sounding synthesized voices that can be implemented into games or other experiences. For cognitive accessibility, there's Azure PlayFab Party Overview, a low-latency chat and data communication solution for cross-platform and cross-device multiplayer games. The voice and text features in Party can be used as a standalone chat solution, and it can provide accessible communication in games. So there's PlayFab Party Speech to Text and Text Display UX Guidelines. And I will share these slides, so and the links are here. PlayFab Party to Text Speech and Text Input UX Guidelines for using PlayFab to provide accessible text-to-speech communication support in games. This is for Unity. There's an accessibility self-assessment tool, which is free. Simple tools that adds a new window into Unity that allows developers to self-assess how accessible your game is or your experience is. There's Read Speaker. It's a plugin with APIs for either Unreal or Unity that can add text-to-speech capabilities to an experience or game. Resource offers free trial and plugin installation videos. For Unity, there's also VR Tunneling Pro, which is free. VR comfort solution for Unity 5.6 Plus. It can be dropped into almost any project for plug-and-play comfort options based on grid and periphery shrinking while moving and turning. For visual accessibility, there's a UI accessibility plugin, UAP. It's free. A plugin for Unity that helps developers make their games more accessible for players who are blind or have low vision. It also includes a tutorial video, documentation, and support forum. There is, for Unity, for visual accessibility, Seeing VR Toolkit. It's a set of 14 tools for Unity that enhance a VR application for people with low vision by providing visual and audio augmentations. There's accessibility. This is text resizing. This is also free. It's a one-click, four-step lightweight solution to add in text resizing. This is a key accessibility feature. And for also for Unity, responsive spatial audio for immersive gaming. This is free. It's a Unity plugin to help developers build accessibility for gamers without sight into 3D game environments. For Unreal, for visual accessibility, there's how to support screen readers. It's a guide to implement screen reader support into the game. For Unreal as well, there's accessible realities. So Unreal plugin to make video games and XR accessible for people who are blind or have low vision. There is, for Unreal, spatialization API references. Unreal classes related to spatial audio, each including reference, syntax, and more. And there's working with audio in Unreal. So resource filled with documentation developers can use to create immersed and accessible audio experiences in their game. And spatial audio template demo level where developers can experience how Unreal can create a great spatial audio experience. A resource also includes a guide developers can use when exploring the level. So there's also how to enable subtitles, a guide on how to enable subtitles into the game. A Yellow Subs Machine, which is a paid, customizable subtitle solution for Unreal Engine 4, covers as many legal and best practice recommendations as possible, and player requested features such as toggleable speaker, color displaying the speaker's tone of voice, and more. There's a colorblind widget, which helps developers apply colorblind correction settings to the game window. Reader Speaker, it's a plugin with APIs for either Unreal or Unity that can add text-to-speech capabilities to a game. And that's it. So I know that was a lot, but I think those are great resources. And what I'll say is one of the things that came out of me examining the tools was saying, well, the tools themselves are not that accessible, yet there are all these plugins that exist. I just wish that the tools themselves had these things actually built in. So that's one part of my research. I want to move on to the next. So in 2020, that lovely year of 2020, I joined Vail. It's an international research group who are looking at design patterns in VR to examine design patterns in VR and expanded on the research by looking specifically at accessibility in VR. So working with Asad Mahmood, we examined how they perform concerning accessibility and inclusivity and how experiences and can improve them. Vail will actually be speaking at ISMAR this October in Singapore about the project overall. And there's a lot of data with this project that I'm not going to get into here because I don't have the time. But I'm just going to high level talk about the things that I worked on over the summer with Assad and some of the titles that we examined. So the current challenges within VR is that there's no focus on accessibility options. There's very little awareness for challenges faced by users, and there's limited development tools available for smaller companies. So one of the things that I've talked to different folks about accessibility and inclusion in the XR space. And one of the things that has been said to me repeatedly by people who are on smaller teams is that they can't do it. Like they don't have the bandwidth for it. They don't know how to do it. So one of the things that I'm working toward, and I'll talk about it a little later, is like I want to be able to make like a some sort of toolkit for a small team of two people to make sure that they're incorporating inclusion and accessibility into whatever it is they're creating. So we explored a few titles last summer. We looked at Beat Saber, Waltz of Wizard, Rec Room, Epic Roller Coasters, Bait, Echo VR. So I'll just quickly go through these. Here I have a little cool animation of a person who's like flying in VR. And there are different titles listed here. So Beat Saber. Users navigate through an obstacle course with emphasis on a song being played. Waltz of Wizard, the user goes through a maze of different challenges to progress through the story. There's also Rec Room, a collection of user-made rooms that a person can join and interact with other people. Epic roller coasters, the user sits through various different roller coaster rides. Just an FYI for people who are working in this field, if somebody is trying VR for the first time, never ever have them do a roller coaster ride. I don't know why people always think that's the first one to try. Don't ever do that for motion sickness issues. Bait, fish, it's a fishing simulator. And Echo VR user plays with other players in a unique sports space. So, what we learned, there are common issues present in most titles, and the type of accessibility options that are offered are limited. Issues with accessibility options were physical reactions, psychological reactions, barriers to entry and widespread adoption, and the cost of head-mounted displays. Because one of the things that's very important to me is thinking about the fact that when we think about XR, it tends to be very Western focused. And the truth is that this technology is very expensive. So, some common issues again, very few accessibility options, lack of extensive tutorials in some titles, little flexibility for different playstyles. and not friendly for smaller spaces. So I actually tweeted this the other day because trying to play anything in my small Brooklyn apartment is not cool at all. I really wish that people who worked on these experiences, they should just do all their testing in my apartment. And if they could play in my apartment, they could probably play anywhere. So that's a big issue, I think. So some common accessibility options that were available were hand tracking, playing while sitting, playing with one hand, haptic feedback, subtitles, room scale or stationary guardian, and different locomotion options. So hand tracking, here I have an image of hands that are trying to go for a red button. So hand tracking doesn't allow full control that the user might have when using a controller. So that was one of the issues. Here I have an image of a person who is sitting on a couch wearing a VR headset with their hand up. And so playing while sitting allows for limited movement when trying to play while sitting and the inability to rotate. Here I have an image of a hand in virtual space, one with a spider and one that's attempting to hold a soccer ball. And then there is a hand that is wearing a haptic feedback to, I don't know how to describe this, but it's wearing something that would provide haptic feedback to a hand. So thinking about haptic feedback was not accurate to what's happening in the experience, and usage of generic feedback was common for most motions. So one thing that I love, that if you haven't seen this, definitely go look it up, is the locomotion vault. Although I will say this, for those who get motion sickness easily, be aware, because they have a lot of GIFs and a lot of this moves. So what I like about the locomotion vault is that it shows the different types of locomotion that are available in VR, but some options might cause issues for the user, such as motion sickness, which is so common when it comes to VR. And again, we focused on on price as well. And one of the barriers for entry and widespread adoption we saw, you know, on a global scale, is the cost. So RS stands for Indian Rupee. So here is a Quest. I have an image of a Quest 2 for $299. That's 50,000 rupee. For a Vive Pro, it's $799. That is 132,000 rupee. For Valve Index, it's $999. That's 165,000 rupee. Basically, the cost of a headset could be some like 1 month's salary. I talked to someone last year who said they wanted to get a Quest and it was 1 month's salary for them. So that is another part. Another part of my research is looking at, and this is recent, is augmented reality heuristics. So our objective is to evaluate existing experiences for inclusion and accessibility, highlight and address key gaps and pain points in XR, understand why these issues are present, think or create a framework, toolkit guidelines that address current design solutions, present guidelines for others to implement readily in their design. So the ultimate deliverables of this will be a framework, toolkit, and guidelines for inclusive and accessible XR experiences, and an example of accessible experience. So we started with a card sort. So card sorting, just for those who are not aware, because this is something commonly used in the user experience design, is a research tool to find how information can be grouped, labeled, and categorized. Users group the information the way they want. You can have an open or closed card sort. So an open card sort allows users to create their own categories with the terms. And a closed card sort gives users a set of categories to group the terms in. So what we did was we thought of the different heuristics related to augmented reality and ultimately gave folks 46 terms to sort in 20 minutes. So I'll just talk a bit about how we got there. We started with this question, how might we fill the gaps in XR? So we use Figma and brainstorm ways to fill the gaps. Then we split up our responses into larger topics, looking at literature review, evaluations, template creation, and usability test. We also looked at this eight-step method for developing and validating heuristics from Kionis et al. So step one is the exploratory stage, gathering information through literature review. Step two is the experimental stage, analyze data obtained in experiments that may provide additional information. Step three is the descriptive stage, highlight important characteristics of previously collected data, formalize those characteristics, and group the formalizations. Step four is the correlation stage, match characteristics of domain-specific heuristics to existing heuristics to ensure new heuristics cover traditional usability concepts. Step five is the selection stage, identify existing heuristics then can be used and or adapted for the new set. Step six is the specification stage, formally specify the new set of heuristics using a standard template. Step seven is the validation stage, validate the new set of heuristics through experiments and other validation methods. And step eight is the refinement stage, refine the set of proposed heuristics based on data gathered in step seven. So this was the start of us getting an idea of what we wanted to do around heuristics. Here I have a screenshot of a Miro board looking at the augmented reality heuristics as well as the Nielsen-Norman heuristics. So we compared the existing Nielsen-Norman heuristics to the augmented reality heuristics, asking what is the overlap and what else is necessary to think about for both AR and VR. So taking our initial ideas, we researched other existing accessibility heuristics and guidelines, looking at the development and validation of a heuristic checklist for VR game design, universal design for learning guidelines, game accessibility guidelines, XR accessibility from the W3C, and the Nielsen-Norman heuristics. So for universal design for learning, here I have a screenshot of three different Miro boards. There's multiple means of engagement, multiple means of action and expression, and multiple means of representation. For the game accessibility guidelines, here I have a screenshot of our Miro board that says on it game design, and we focused on visual, cognition, general, hearing, speech, and motor. And then the W3 XR accessibility guidelines, here I have a screenshot of a Miro board with the different accessibility guidelines that I referred to earlier in the presentation. There's also the 10 Nielsen heuristics, so here I have a screenshot of our Miro board of those heuristics. And our scholarly VR game dissertation, here's a screenshot of the scholarly references that we found. So compiling the initial heuristics, so after synthesizing all the information from the five guidelines, we compiled them into a Google Doc. We took out redundant sections across all guidelines and added some that we thought were missing through other research and experiences, working on making the language easy to understand. Because one of the things that I think needs to be in place when thinking about some sort of heuristics is language that is simple enough for folks regardless of the language that they speak. So this is us with our post-it notes and whiteboard. That's what I have an image of here. So we started with sticky notes and whiteboards and thought of heuristics that could create an accessible experience. And ultimately, we decided on doing a card sort. So why did we do the card sort? To see how our users would organize information we had collected and grouped, making sure it was based on the user's mindset rather than our own. and doing the research. So one of the things that we did was we did some user testing using Google Maps AR view, walking across the street from our building. So this user testing taught us that the screen would go dark when it detects motion, and this was not explained, and that there was a limitation due to technological limitations. Users had to go outside, and it didn't help us navigate indoors. So here I have some screenshots of the user testing. There's four different screenshots of us using the Google Maps AR experience. And then ultimately, out of that, we developed physical cards. So here I have a screenshot of different index cards on a table. And we created a set of heuristics. So we ultimately turned it into a game. So here on the screen is an image of a box that says common practice card sort. And our instructions for the card sort were to sort the cards into categories you think they belong in. There are no wrong answers. There was one player. They had 25 minutes. And that there were two ways to play the game, open or closed. Open, place all the cards on the table. Think about what categories would these cards be in. Grab a pen and a note card and start to write out categories you might put the cards under. Or closed, lay all the category cards out on the table face up and place them at the top. Place the terms cards in the category you think they belong. So part two was that there are no right or wrong answers. Again, they had 25 minutes to complete the task, and there were two decks. So the reflections for the user at the end were any specifics about their identities or knowledge change in this their result of the card sort. Were there any challenges that the user faced while sorting? Here I have three different images of the cards, the physical cards wrapped in rubber band, and one with a person holding the card. So we did both moderated and unmoderated card sort. Moderated, during moderated card sorts, you can ask questions about specific cards and placements and observe insights of the user during the sorting process. And unmoderated card sorts have users sort cards without an interaction with the facilitator, unable to speak to the user during or soon after the sort. We also had the paper version and a digital card sort. So the paper was a traditional form, flexible process. They could move the cards physically. And the digital, they were using a web-based tool. Users could drag and drop into categories. So here I have a screenshot of the physical cards. And here is an image of the digital cards that we used using Miro. So this is also, this is a closed card sort where we gave the categories, and this is a screenshot of the Miro card sort. We also were able to at NYU, they have a game night. So we were able to do some of the card sort during game night. And I am still recruiting for this. So if anybody is interested in doing a card sort, please let me know. I know I'm running out of time and I wanna allow for Q&A. So this is still ongoing. Also, my Isabella, who is on here, Isabella has been researching augmented reality filters and specifically focusing on Instagram, because I have another project with Arissa Labs that is making NASA eclipse accessible for folks in the blind and low vision community. And Isabella is working on a filter, which I think will be very cool. It should be ready and released by the end of the summer. But Isabella discovered about Instagram. Instagram is a screen reader accessible for posts only. Stories and reels are not screen reader friendly. There is a caption sticker available for stories, which is kind of like Instagram's version of I don't know what. And then they're working towards making an accessible filter for this platform, but it hasn't happened yet. So that's just a side. So I would love to talk more about, this is another piece of my research. This is Immersive Story Labs Africa. There in 2020, Femi created Historias Immersas, the Spanish language version of Stories Lab, which won a Journalism 360 grant from the online news. The grant supported Historias Immersas aimed to use storytelling to share the stories of underrepresented groups in Colombia. Immersive Stories Lab Africa is working with librarians in Namibia, Ghana, Nigeria, Uganda, and Zimbabwe. And we are working with them to provide supplies and support for making experiences accessible. Some of the stories that are coming out of that will be featured in my upcoming book with Doug Northcook titled Human Spatial Computing through Oxford University Press, which will be coming out next year. So I'll end with this quote. Everything around us has been designed, even systems of inequality. That's from Antoinette Carroll. And, you know, we have an opportunity to create a more equitable future. So how can we make sure that we are designing inclusive and equitable outcomes for all, no matter how big or small the decision? So what's next for me is in the fall of 22, I'm going to have a VIP program, which is vertically integrated projects, where I will have more folks who are working with me. My solicitation has been approved from the NFB to get folks who are screen reader users to do some evaluations around web VR. And my hope soon is to work with some AR/VR companies to increase awareness of accessibility issues. And my book, Human Spatial Computing, will be out next year, hopefully next fall. So thank you. That was a lot. I did a lot of talking, so I'm going to stop sharing my screen now. Thank you, everybody.
Wow. Thank you so much, Regine. That was a fantastic talk. You shared a lot of really useful information. And actually, to that point, I just wanted to highlight Dylan's comments. These would be great tools to add to the XR Access GitHub. We have an accessibility page, so he dropped that link in the chat. And I'd like to open it up now to any questions. You can go ahead and drop those in the chat. I can read them out.
I know some of it was dry, so I was like trying to get through, but I think it's all important stuff.
It wasn't dry, Reginé. It was
thank you, Ren.
Informative. No, I'm like, I'm looking forward to this being posted. And I'm just going to shove people that way.
Oh, well.
That was so good.
Yes.
Yeah, man. Or I'm happy to chat. I mean, whatever. It's fine. Or Isabella, I don't know if you have anything to add. I will say this, it was very ambitious of me to choose this as my research area because there is so much to it. And so I thought I would start at the beginning, right? Like what are people doing to create this stuff? And what do creators actually need help with? Because thinking about when, you know, I teach people about accessibility when they know nothing about it. And so I think it gives me a good place to start for folks who may know nothing about creating accessible XR experiences to give them some sort of guidelines. So that's what I'm focusing on now.
Yeah, I love that perspective. I actually do have, I have a question.
Yeah.
When you're going through the different tools that are out there to try and make different applications accessible, but you mentioned that the tools themselves are oftentimes not accessible. I guess, what do you see as a way we can move towards closing that gap? Or I guess maybe what would you say is some of the biggest barriers to making the accessibility tools themselves accessible?
Well, I think a lot, you know, I've talked to different people in different companies, and even when I remember tweeting, like, I'm looking to get in touch with people who work in accessibility and Unity and Unreal and da da da. It was a little hard to find. It was hard to find those people. And it was like through, I don't know, through different channels, I was able to speak with some folks. And I know there is some progress, but it goes back to the matter, I think, that we, you know, when I think about accessibility as a whole, the root cause of the accessibility issues we have, what I've identified, is ableism, right? And so I think until accessibility impacts someone, they don't care about it. And that's just what I've seen, both working on the corporate side as a UX designer and trying to get folks to get accessibility and not caring about it until they did, right? So yeah, that's kind of, I think, at the root of it is ableism.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah, thank you for that answer.
Yeah.
We have a question from Cassandra. I'm sorry, I hope I said that right. Are any of the plugins you discovered open source? Are there ways to leverage the tech or code behind those in order to build them into XR experiences?
Yeah, that's a very good question. I think a few of the resources, and again, I'll send that list to you so it can be posted somewhere. I don't know if it could be part of the YouTube or whatever, but I'll provide that list. That's a good question. I'm not sure which ones are open source, but I know some of them are. Are there ways to leverage the tech or code behind those? I think so. I think we just haven't. So yes to that. Is there another?
Yes, we have from Lee. Could you share more research/opinions about accessibility design for elder people in XR?
Oh, well, I don't think there's much of a, if we're thinking about accessibility will also impact elders. So when thinking about things from an elder perspective, right, text needs to be bigger for sure, you know, as folks get older, hearing loss. So I think a lot of the things that are already part of accessible design apply to elders. What I do think that folks need to do is talk to elders, one, because, you know, nothing about us without us. But thinking about the, you know, I think we all have someone in our lives who is like resistant to technology and don't want to necessarily use it, or they feel they're too old and the learning curve. I think overall industry can do a better job of onboarding folks to learn how to use things, because I think a lot of times that there's a huge gap and a big assumption about what people know how to do. So that's my answer there.
Awesome. Thank you. And we have a comment from Bob. Bob says their own research back in their with their in their sorry in their research background, they were turning third person games into first person games to add accessibility. They worry that starting in first person, the number of channels to express modalities is already full.
Oh, that's a good. I think that could. That's a. That requires a deeper dive than we have time for. But yeah, I would love to talk to you, Bob.
Awesome. And let's see, is there another question? Let's see. As mentioned, XR is still a very expensive tech and is still in the developing stages. Incorporating accessibility principles in the early designs would go a long way in making XR more usable. Thank you. It's a comment from Pallavi. I apologize if I did not pronounce that correctly.
Yeah, and another thing to think about too, because I'm working with you know, folks in Africa and down in Peru, is internet connection. And the fact that there's a big assumption around internet connection that everybody has high speed. The United States still has half of the United States does not have high speed internet. And so thinking about connecting these devices, which are already expensive, to something that's maybe not as stable, not everyone is using a Quest. A lot of the work that's being done in different parts of the world is more mobile based, right? So folks using their mobile devices for 360 VR and doing storytelling in that way. So I think we have to expand our perspective of the way that we're approaching VR is not just, again, this Western point of view where I can afford the headset, I can afford to have high speed internet. There are plenty of people who are working on stuff and creating experiences that are not related to those things, right? And thinking about how can people experience, I mean, I think XR is so awesome and can open so many doors for people to experience things they never have before. And I don't think that price or someone's income or where they live should be a barrier to it. So how is it that we can, again, make things a little bit more equitable? I don't have those answers, but I'm hoping to get there.
Awesome. And we are coming up on the hour. I'm going to try to get to at least one or two more questions from Richard. Do you by chance also follow legal updates in this area, example, accessibility lawsuits? If so, any updates we should be aware of?
Yeah, so there's a case, a pending case right now with virtual reality and someone who is deaf. It hasn't been brought to trial yet. But if this case, we'll see how far it goes, but it may prompt industry to change things depending on what happens. I think in the United States specifically, I'm referring to at this point in time, there are plenty of lawsuits around accessibility, and it hasn't necessarily bridged over to the XR space yet. Because it's still so new, but I think we're going to see a lot more things happening in this area. So I don't have any full updates, but there is ongoing litigation in process.
Awesome. Thank you for that. And I'm going to combine these last questions. Are there resources for thinking about cost, time, potential impact when it comes to how smaller organizations should prioritize different dimensions of inclusion? And I guess what requirements are already in place to help?
The answer is no, and that's what I'm working on. So yeah, short answer, but yeah. There are plenty of resources out there. Is there a set of places, you know, people have to go to different resources in order. And my goal is to have a set of heuristics around AR and a set of heuristics around VR and points of reference that people can go to if they have questions. And I have ideas in my head about how to make this a little bit more accessible in general that I will be sharing in the new year. I will be making something, I'll just say that.
Amazing. Thank you so much. Let's give Reginé a hand, another hand.
Oh, thank you. Thank you all for being here. Thank you, everybody.
And just flashing a bit of information from XR Access. If you'd like to get involved, you can join our Slack. You can become a member and also follow us on Twitter or email at info@xraccess.edu. And I'm going to, if I can get my screen share together, put this information on the screen. And Dylan, could I bother you to put these in the chat?
Oh. No problem.
Thank you so much. Okay. Oh, that is the wrong button.
It And join XR Access. I can't say this enough. I highly, highly recommend, if you are interested in this area and you are not a member, to join. I am a proud member.
Thank I'm you. Glad because that's how I met you.
Yes.
So join, you will meet awesome people. Yeah.
Awesome. Thank you everyone for joining. Thank you. And I hope you two all have a great rest of the day.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you. Bye.
Goodbye. Thanks. I'll send you, I'll be sending a link probably tomorrow with the list of those tools.